As the Final Fantasy franchise prepared to arrive on the PlayStation 2, the developers looked at how best to embark on this brand new adventure. With amazing technology at their fingertips, they knew that they could really drive presentation values to the next level. It meant that we would receive a higher fidelity of music, we would see the extensive use of high quality FMV sequences, and of course, we would see, or rather hear, the arrival of voice acting. Alongside this, having learnt from their three previous endeavours, the developers also knew about the need for a strong protagonist who could help to carry the burden of attempting to project the Final Fantasy franchise to new heights and to new audiences. They therefore wanted to make sure that Tidus was a good fit for this responsibility, and it saw him undergo numerous changes throughout the game's development, as Yoshinori Kitase and Kazushige Najima played around with his character to work in with the adaptations that they were making to the game's wider narrative. In its earliest forms, Final Fantasy X was meant to be focused on a world where people would die when they turned 17 years of age. At this point, instead of being a happy-go-lucky sports star with bundles of energy and copious amounts of enthusiasm, Tidus was instead planned to be a plumber, who was not only angry at life, but was also part of a group of delinquents. Kitase noted though that, upon reflection, they felt as though this would make for a weak main character, so his backstory was changed almost entirely. This then worked in with changes that they were making to the wider narrative, and instead of having a protagonist that was planned to be very much a part of Spira from the get-go, we ended up with a protagonist who was instead an outsider, someone who would be introduced to the world of Spira with fresh eyes, who would mirror the experiences of the player. Now, character development through learning was something we saw quite a lot of in Final Fantasy IX, as it was a big part of how both Zidane and Vivi grew as characters. And although the angle was slightly different between the two of these characters, with Tidus the spin was much more unique. Instead of being presented with characters who were essentially still juveniles in many ways, now we had a character who was not only developed physically, but due to their standing in life, was also developed psychologically. Tidus was a star in his own right, but after being ripped straight from his world, he was reduced to nothing, and was forced to build himself back up in a world that he knew nothing about. To me, this is what makes Tidus such a fascinating character. Sure, he plays some mean Blitzball and has plenty of attitude, but there's a sense of connection with the player that hadn't really existed before in the franchise. And the developers were very clever with how they chose to present this. From the use of the Albid language through to the retrospective storytelling, much was done to make you feel just as in the dark as Tidus, to help you root for him and his journey, and I'm guessing that's why so many of you have been looking forward to this video. Because for all the flack that Tidus gets around that laughing scene, he's just a damn good main protagonist. Now, before we dive into Tidus's origins though, I just need to say that yes, I will be pronouncing his name as Tidus throughout this video. We did a poll recently, and although Tidus actually won the majority vote, because it's very much the official way now, with him even being referred to as Tidus in the new event that's taking place in Mobius, it's time to concede and accept that Tidus is the way forward. The balance has very much shifted. Hopefully the Tidus lovers amongst us are alright with this, but if not, I'm sorry in advance. Saying Tidus though is still a bit unnatural for me, but I'll try my best to make sure I'm consistent throughout what's going to be the longest Origins video to date. Also, I just want to make sure to remind everyone that even if you are already subscribed to Final Fantasy Union, make sure you hit that bell notification button to make sure you get notified when we publish new content. Also, make sure you let us know in the comments who you'd like us to see cover in a future Origins video. Alright, so let's get started with Tidus's origins. Tidus was born 17 years prior to when the events of Final Fantasy X took place, but he wasn't born in the conventional sense. Yes, he did have parents, with his father being Jecht, the famed Blitzball player from the Zanarkand Abes, but it's more where he was born that requires more explanation, as he was born within a dream, not within the typical reality of Spira. And to understand more about how this particular turn of events came to pass, we need to delve into the depths of Spira's past. Thousands of years prior to the events of the main game, the Spiran population started to enter into a new age following the invention of machina. These were machines created by magic users as a way of enhancing their lives and making them even more superior to those who had limited to no affinity with magic at all. But as time passed, Machina revolutionized Spira in ways that the magic users could not have predicted. Non-magic users had a strong affinity with creating and wielding Machina, and through continued advancement, were able to create Machina that helped them to achieve previously impossible feats. Due to this newfound confidence, these non-magic users started to gain a voice within society. The Machina had helped to level the playing field and remove some of the social inequalities that had existed between the magic users and the non-magic users. But things didn't stay this way for long, as the non-magic users, who were now called the Bador, weren't satisfied with their progress. They were keen to see just how powerful Machina could become, and this desire threatened the magic users. Things became even more heightened when Alb, one of the prominent members of the Bador, defeated a mage from Zanarkand in combat due to the use of Machina that he had created. It acted as a wake-up call to the mages that their power was no longer absolute, and they therefore began to surveil the Bador to ensure that they were kept in their place. This therefore led to hostilities, and it's believed that their continued work in the field of combat Machina was the catalyst for the war that broke out between the city of Bavel, who were pro-Machina and extremely advanced in this field, and the city of Zanarkand, who were pro-magic and believed that the use of Machina should be a privilege, not a right. This war had a devastating impact on Spira, and despite having achieved over a millennia of superiority, the summoners of Zanarkand were now outmatched and outgunned. Their leader, Yuyevan, therefore hatched a plan that would see his side be victorious, but at a great cost. He turned all of the citizens of Zanarkand, except his daughter Yunaleska and her husband Zeon, into faith so that Zanarkand could be preserved in a dream state. This replica of Zanarkand had a physical location though, and although it couldn't be easily accessible by anyone who was living, Yuyevan summoned Sin, a fearsome creature who would be tasked with protecting this new dream metropolis. For centuries and centuries, as Dream Zanarkand persevered, Sin continued to act as its guardian, eliminating anything and anyone that could be perceived as a threat. But the faith began to grow tired of preserving Dream Zanarkand, and therefore looked for ways to defeat Yuyevan so that they could rest. And this is a task that they bestowed on Tidus, a young man whose father had managed to become the first known person to leave Dream Zanarkand and, essentially, become real. This event occurred when Tidus was only 7 years old, and it had a significant impact on his life, but not in a way that anyone could have expected. Even though Tidus's mother loved him, she also adored his father Jecht, and as Tidus became more aware of this, he began to resent his father. As he developed, Tidus therefore gained the incorrect perception that his father was actively stealing his mother's attention away from him. And when combined with his father's drunken behavior and general lack of sympathy towards anything bad that happened in his life, this resentment turned towards hatred. When his father then disappeared, Tidus made his mother aware of just how much he hated his father, telling her that he never wanted to see him again and wishing that he wouldn't ever return. She didn't quite know how to take this though, and decided to encourage Tidus to see his father again, if only so that he could say how much he hated him. But it made no difference. Tidus was set on lashing out against his absent father, and nothing his mother could do could change this. Because as far as Tidus was concerned, with Jecht gone, he would now receive the love and attention he had always felt he deserved. Unfortunately though, the disappearance of Jecht changed nothing in their relationship, as instead of neglecting Tidus due to fawning over Jecht, his mother neglected him because she pined for Jecht's return and spent most of her time waiting outside on the boathouse hoping to see him once again. This ended up making her quite ill, and a year later, Tidus's mother passed away from what was ultimately a broken heart. It meant that the now 8-year-old Tidus was left with no parents from who he could learn and share experiences with, but he did gain a new mentor, a man named Auron who had known Jecht and who proceeded to watch over him until the time was right. Now, even though Jecht was gone, he was still very much a part of Tidus's life due to how much his disappearance had affected everyone. The citizens of Dream Zanarkand had chosen to immortalize Jecht, as they deemed him to be one of the greatest Blitzball players of all time, and as part of this, they created an event called the Jecht Memorial Cup. Growing up as Jecht's son, therefore, wasn't very easy for Tidus. Due to the family connection, he was constantly living in his father's shadow, and Tidus felt the only way to step out from it was to make his own legacy, so that he could surpass everything that his father had achieved. He therefore resolved to become a Blitzball player, like his father, and at the age of 16, he made his debut as a player for the Zanarkand Abes, his father's old team. In the following year, Tidus started to gain some recognition for his accomplishments in the sport, and it led to him being referred to as the star player of the Zanarkand Abes. As a result, he started to attract a solid fanbase, and in the build-up to the Jecht Memorial Cup, even though people like Zaynar had reminisced about the disappearance of his father, Tidus was also very much in the conversation in his own right. But while Tidus focused on performing well in the game, there were other plans afoot, as an idea that Jecht and Auron had hatched almost a decade prior was finally ready to be put in motion. They aimed to bring Tidus out of Dream Zanarkand so that he too could become real. It's just that nobody told Tidus about this plan, and even though the faith of Bahamut attempted to make him aware that maybe something was about to happen that evening, it was still rather shocking for him to see his home being destroyed before his very eyes. In the aftermath of the initial attack, Tidus was naturally rather confused. His city was in ruins. He was witnessing strange occurrences like time stopping, and Auron was choosing to walk towards the peril, not away from it. Auron also started talking about something called sin, and to make things even weirder, he offered Tidus a sword that was a gift from his father. But there was no time to comprehend any of this. Tidus was in mortal danger, and the only thing he could do was to push forward and fight, which he did, until he was ultimately sucked into the depths of sin, which made him become real, and transported him to the nearest closest civilization, Baj Temple. When Tidus awoke, Auron was nowhere to be found, and instead of seeing the bright city lights that he'd been used to his whole life, he was now stuck in a load of muggy water in the middle of some derelict ruins. And not just that, the fiends around were pretty hell-bent on attempting to kill him. After barely managing to escape with his life, Tidus was left to reflect on the rather dire situation, and after struggling to find anything useful in the way of food, he became convinced that he was probably going to die there. It just so happened though, that an owlbed salvage crew were rummaging through the barred ruins, and after initially mistaking him for a fiend, decided to take Tidus with them, forcing him into labour in exchange for some food and some less than desirable lodgings. By this point, Tidus found himself extremely frustrated. He'd gone from being the belle of the ball in Zanarkand to being stuck with a load of funny looking guys who were not only rather hostile, but also couldn't understand a word he was saying. Still, it was a slight upgrade on his previous situation inside the barge ruins, and when he found out that one of the crew members called Riku could not only understand him, but could also speak his language, Tidus' spirits lifted. He instantly reverted back to his previous self. Greeting Riku in a somewhat patronizing tone as if she were a would-be fan of his, and then proudly telling her that he was the star player of the Zanarkand Abes, as if this would impress her. But when he didn't get the response he was looking for, the two ended up in a kind of discord. Riku didn't believe that Tidus could possibly be from Zanarkand, as it was destroyed 1,000 years prior, and Tidus, having just witnessed it being destroyed, refused to believe that what he had seen took place such a long time ago in the past. Being someone of strong conviction, Tidus knew within himself that he was telling the truth. Yes, he had been close to sin, so he could be suffering from amnesia, but everything was just so surreal. Even if he knew nothing about the people or the places that Riku was talking about, there was absolutely no way that sin could have transported him 1,000 years into the future. But when he then heard the same thing from Waka, having washed up on the shore of Perseid, Tidus started to think that maybe he had indeed travelled through time. Gone was the bravado and the arrogance. It had been replaced by a calm resignation of his fate. Tidus therefore chose to heed Riku's advice. He resolved not to tell people anything about his past in Zanarkand, and chose to just accept his new life until the situation arose that maybe he could try to find his way back home. Fortunately, he had showed prowess with Blitzball, and Waka had been impressed. And this, combined with the fact that he looked remarkably like his newly deceased brother, Chapu, led Waka to encourage Tidus to join his team, the Perseid Aurochs, so that he could play in an upcoming Blitzball tournament. When they arrived at Perseid, Tidus tried his best to align himself with his new surroundings, but due to his complete ignorance, he started to ruffle some feathers with the residents. Gato was offended by his lack of knowledge regarding the Crusaders, and people praying within the Besaid Temple were shocked when he didn't even know what a High Summoner was. This paled in comparison to his next big faux pas though, as he defied the temple precepts and hundreds of years of tradition by rushing into the Cloister of Trials when he heard that a summoner inside might be in danger. Wacha was somewhat forgiving about this flagrant action, but the guardians inside and the people who lived in the town were less than impressed. Some considered him to be nothing more than a heathen who spat in the face of everything they believed. The important thing was though, that Yuna, the summoner they found inside the cloister, didn't seem to be offended by his actions, and she even asserted that she'd actually like to learn more about him and where he was from. And so, the next day, the two spoke about Tidus's past, or more specifically, their shared past, as they had something in common, Jecht. But before they could reminisce too much, they were interrupted by Sin, and it was yet another wake-up call to Tidus about the perils of his new situation. Tidus bore witness again to the destructive capabilities of Sin, as this time it decimated Kilika. But unlike last time, where he was whisked away prematurely, this time he got to see the brutal reality of the aftermath, as well as Yuna's more expanded role in Spear and life. It led him to question whether playing Blitzball was really the right thing to do. He didn't feel it was appropriate for them to be enjoying themselves and having fun when there was so much suffering in the world. In general though, Tidus just had absolutely no idea what was going on, and the more time he spent in Spira, the worse it was getting. When Yuna then requested that Tidus join her party as a guardian as opposed to just going along to play in the Blitzball tournament, he was even more confused. As much as he liked the fact that Yuna seemed to be interested in him and wanted him to be closer to her, he had no clue what being a guardian actually meant, and it kind of freaked him out. As they then completed the Kilika Cloister of Trials and gained the strength of Ifrit, Tidus continued to see connections between the two worlds, and things started to get too much. He had previously noticed that the Prayer of Yevon was similar to the Blitzball celebration, but he also recognized the Hymn of the Faith, and when he then saw Yuna surrounded by well-wishers following her completion of the cloister, the feelings inside him became too hard to bear. Tidus had tried hard to believe that there was no going back, but the truth was, he desperately missed his home. He missed the adoration of his fans, the safety and the security he felt back in Zanarkand, and just the general feel of comfort. All that he could do to make sure that he didn't suffer some kind of breakdown was to scream at the top of his lungs, and doing so seemed to help him, even if nobody else really understood what he was going through. On the way to Lucca, Tidus therefore had a lot of things to reflect upon. Would he ever truly adapt to this new world? Every time he opened his mouth, he seemed to make himself look stupid or just offend people. And then there was his relationship with Yuna. On a superficial level, Tidus thought she was attractive, but as he started to learn more about Spira, summoners, and guardians, he was unsure about whether or not he should proceed. Yuna though was making it very clear that she wanted to protect Tidus, even to the detriment of her own social standing. But was this because of who he was, or because he was simply just the son of Sir Jecht, a man that he despised? When Tidus then heard Wacker and Lulu talking about their reservations around Yuna's motivations, it then clouded things even further in his mind. But in this time of uncertainty, Tidus remembered his ambitions, to surpass his father and create his own legacy. He thought back to a time when his father belittled him for wanting to practice Blitzball before showing him the Jecht shot and claiming he'd never be good enough to master it. It lit a fire within him, and Tidus resolved to try and learn it, something he succeeded in doing. But after perfecting the shot, Tidus was brought back down to earth by the realization that his father may actually still be alive somewhere in Spira. And when he found out that Auron was also a guardian alongside his father, he was keen to hunt him down so that he could question him on what had been going on, as well as this now hidden past. When they did eventually reunite after the Blitzball tournament, Tidus was beyond angry. He let all his frustrations pour out and blamed Auron for everything bad that had happened to him since the day of the Jecht Memorial Cup. In response, Auron just laughed in his face, a lot, and it led to Tidus questioning who Auron even was. This was a man who had spent a large portion of his life looking after and watching over Tidus, but he had never once mentioned the relationship to his father. Why? Why would he have withheld that information? The bombshells didn't stop there though, as after Auron confirmed that he had indeed known Tidus' father and had watched over him at his father's behest, he also revealed that Sin was Jecht. The ravenous monster that caused so much pain and suffering in the world was Tidus' father. It meant that if Tidus didn't have enough reason to hate his father already, he now had even more, and this news sent Tidus into another outburst towards Auron. It was just too much to comprehend in such a short space of time. Tidus' world had literally been flipped upside down since his arrival in Spira, and these latest revelations about Sin and about him having been chosen, they were just beyond crazy. But what choice did he have other than to go with Auron? He had been his mentor for much of his life, and in this strange foreign land, he would be silly to just leave his side to find his own path, especially as he seemed to know so much about what was going on. Tidus therefore reluctantly chose to continue travelling alongside Yuna and the other guardians after Auron offered his services to the fledgling summoner. When Auron made this proclamation to Yuna, Tidus was visibly annoyed, acting like a spoilt child who had to accompany their parent on a trip they didn't want to make. And Yuna noticed this, and therefore attempted to cheer him up. First, she showed him that she'd perfected the whistle that Tidus had previously tried to teach her for if they got separated. But when that didn't work, she requested that he smile and laugh out loud. It was difficult at first, but it was just what Tidus needed, and after seeing him soften up, Yuna made Tidus a promise that if they ever got separated again, that he should whistle so that she could come to his aid. It was the first time the pair truly connected, as their previous interactions had been rather uncomfortable and pretty awkward, but it would ultimately set the tone for what would become a strong partnership based around the concept of laughter and happiness. After this, Tidus gained renewed vigour. He felt much more at ease with the group, but it meant he started to cause unintentional pain to Yuna. She realised that there was something special between them, but instead of making her a flutter, it made her feel quite the opposite, for she knew that even if she did indeed fall for Tidus, defeating Sin would mean that their life together would be nothing more than a fleeting dream due to the sacrifice she would have to make. Yuna therefore decided to record a sphere, so that she could try to process the emotional state this had all left her in, but she was interrupted by Tidus. After this interruption, she tried to entertain polite conversation by sharing that she would love nothing more than to live a peaceful life for the rest of her days, and Tidus, with all his enthusiasm, optimism, and naivety, failed completely to read the situation. Instead of recognizing that Yuna was fragile in this moment, he tried to psych her up by talking about how she shouldn't worry about such things because she can do it all after Sin's defeated, and that she could even try to defeat Sin multiple times. He had no idea that this was actually doing the opposite of what he intended, but Yuna was too polite to say. Not too long after, Tidus had his first real meeting with Maester Seymour, and he was less than impressed. Gom was the fearless maester who had protected the people of Luca, and in his place was a man who flaunted his position and projected an arrogance. He felt that he was above the teachings that so many held dear. And what he authorized as part of this show of arrogance left Tidus disgusted. And after Operation Meehan failed, Tidus took it upon himself to chase Sin down and confront the monster. It accomplished nothing, but he did feel a connection there, and Auron explained afterwards that the maliciousness of the attacks was Jecht's way of incentivizing Tidus to end his life. He also explained that he was only telling Tidus all of this so that he wouldn't become unnecessarily emotional at a critical point, as he'd heard from Jecht that Tidus had a bit of a reputation. Soon after, Tidus bore witness again to the arrogance of Seymour, as he asked for Yuna's hand in marriage. Tidus was rather shocked when he heard and later attempted to deny any sense of jealousy, but he genuinely couldn't understand why Yuna would even be considering the proposal. When she then decided to accept, Tidus was amongst the more ardent protesters, and it was clear that she was hiding something. But as Auron explained, she was doing so to protect everyone else, something which made Tidus even more uncomfortable about the whole situation. But after pondering on the whole thing, in a way he felt somewhat more at ease. He realised that Yuna wasn't marrying Seymour for love, she was duty bound, and it meant there was no chance of anything ever progressing between the two of them. With this resolution, Tidus then started to take his responsibilities as a guardian actually more seriously. There was no longer an undertone to his actions. While this situation was all developing, Tidus also started to learn more about his father. Upon finding a Jecht sphere, Auron explained that spending time in Spira had changed Jecht, and that he was constantly wanting to get back home to see the son that he loved. This also made Tidus somewhat uncomfortable, and all these things combined meant that when he found out the truth about Jiskul Guado's death, he became emotionally charged and confronted Seymour at Macalania Temple. After they then defeated Seymour, Tidus was still in an emotional state, so while the others were able to comprehend the gravity of what they'd just done, he initially just couldn't see it. He figured that it would all just blow over if they explained that Seymour was a bad guy. But he quickly realized that this wasn't going to be so simple. Seymour was, after all, a maester of Yevon, and after speaking to the others, he came to terms with what they'd done. They didn't have too long to dwell on this though, as although Yuna resolved to go to Bavel to speak to Maester Micah about the whole situation, they were instead transported to Bicknell Island by Sin. And once there, they found everything in absolute chaos as the Owlbed were being attacked by, of all people, the Guado. While there, they found out more about why the Owlbed had been kidnapping summoners. They wanted to prevent them from making the ultimate sacrifice to save their lives. Upon learning this, the other guardians understood the Owlbed, but Tidus, he was still absolutely clueless about the whole affair. He still believed that the guardians should be the ones that kept the summoners safe, and as had been the case for much of the pilgrimage so far, nobody could bring it upon themselves to actually tell him the truth. That was until Riku had finally had enough of his ignorance about how the summoner's pilgrimage concluded. Tidus had been on a roller coaster of emotion since arriving in Spira, but this was the straw that broke the camel's back. He couldn't comprehend how everyone could effectively support Yuna's decision to end her own life, and he thought back to all the times he told Yuna about what they could do after her pilgrimage. It was heartbreaking for Tidus, but it made him realize one thing. His feelings for her were real, and he therefore resolved to find Yuna, to save her, and to tell her that he was sorry. Upon hearing all of this, Cid wasn't compelled. As Yuna's uncle, he also had a vested interest in her safety, and it wasn't until Tidus promised that he would stop Yuna from dying that Cid accepted to work with the group so that they could try to find his niece. When they then found that Yuna was being held captive at the palace of St. Bavel, Cid was impressed with Tidus' appetite for the fight, and Tidus then led the charge to save Yuna in a daring assault. But although they fought valiantly, they were too late. Sina was successful in marrying Yuna, and after using the guardians as pawns, Seymour ordered the execution of Tidus and the rest of them. Fortunately, they were temporarily saved due to the actions of Yuna, but in the aftermath, they were sentenced to the Via Purifico, an open prison with no chance of escape. Well, only a small chance of escape. And it just so happened that they all did manage to escape, but things were now so different. Yuna had been betrayed by Yevon and was unsure what to do next. Nobody felt they were in a position to help her decide how to proceed, but they encouraged Tidus to try, and in doing so, he showed some great maturity. He initially apologized for all the things he had said due to his ignorance and asked Yuna for forgiveness. But when Yuna declared that she was actually happy to hear his vision of the future, Tidus suggested that maybe she should just give up on her pilgrimage, and for a short time, Yuna entertained this option. Together, they spoke about what life would be like for them if they could make their way back to Dream Zanarkand, but when Tidus saw that Yuna was crying, he embraced her and realized that their life in Dream Zanarkand was nothing more than a fairy tale. He was Yuna's guardian, and it wasn't his role to try and dissuade her from her path, it was his role to help her fulfill her ambitions and dreams, and with that in mind, he promised to stay with her, always. It was at this point that Tidus thought back to the promise he'd made to Cid, and he resolved even harder to try and find a way to prevent Yuna's death. As they then reached the steps of Zanarkand, Tidus confessed to the group that his father had become Sin, but before everyone was able to fully process what this meant, Tidus was wrenched unconscious by touching the faith and was transported back to a version of Dream Zanarkand. Here, he learnt the truth about his existence, that he was a dream of the faith, and that if the faith stopped dreaming, he would no longer exist. But he also learned that to stop dreaming was what they wished for, and they were looking for Tidus and Jecht to help them. When he awoke, Tidus acted as if nothing had happened, but the reality was, he had to make a choice, and it was almost identical to the one that was being faced by Yuna. Should he sacrifice himself to ease the suffering of many, or choose to walk away and carry on living his own life? For now though, his own choice wasn't all that pressing, as when they found out how the final Aeon was supposed to be created, Tidus changed his opinion yet again about Yuna's pilgrimage, and after showing some youthful petulance, he refused to let her proceed. Yuna though wasn't about to let someone else dictate her path, and she decided to proceed with her pilgrimage, albeit after making Yuna Leska answer some rather tough questions. Tidus then watched as Yuna herself decided to go against the teachings of Yevon, and together they defeated Yunalesca, an action which vanquished any hope of calling upon the final Aeon. They then ventured to see Maester Micah to see if he would have any insight in how they could defeat Sin, but after he willingly decided to accept death, they visited the Faith of Bahamut. Nobody questioned how or why Tidus could see or speak to the Faith, but during the interaction, Tidus received confirmation of not only how he should go about ending the cycle, but also that he would indeed vanish once the deed was done. Upon making their way inside Sin, Tidus came face to face with his father, Jecht. It was something Tidus had dreamt about for years, but after spending time in Spira and learning more about the man his father truly was, Tidus was conflicted. He still had strong resentment towards his father, but he also appreciated that he did the best that he could. He just didn't quite know how to show his son that he loved him. It meant that although Tidus wanted to follow up on something his mother had said to him a decade prior, when he uttered the words, "I hate you," it was through gritted teeth. It was a very emotional situation for Tidus. He didn't want to lose his father again, and he knew that this was the last point for him to back out if he ever wanted to survive himself. But he knew what he ultimately had to do, and to that end, with the support of his friends, they were able to defeat Jecht and bring about the final showdown with the summoner, Yuyevon. As they prepared for this fight, Tidus then revealed to everyone the truth, that this would be the last time they would fight together, as after the defeat of Yuyevon, he would disappear. And as Yuna then performed an emotional sending for her aeons, Tidus saw that the prophecy of the Faith was coming true. He was fading away, their dream was ending. He had performed the sacrifice that Yuna always believed would be hers, and for that, she thanked him, for he had fulfilled his role as her guardian. He had laid down his life for her. With tears in his eyes, Tidus embraced Yuna one last time, before jumping from the Fahrenheit, where he entered the Far Plane and high-fived his old man. After the defeat of Sin, life moved on for the citizens of Spira, but Yuna continued to search for Tidus, and after 2 years, she found a way of reviving him thanks to the Faith. But the Tidus who returned wasn't the same as the one who had disappeared 2 years prior. Riku noticed that he was emotionally different, and physically different too, lacking the previous lighthearted nature and his natural strength. Tidus theorized that this may be because the Faith had tried to gather his thoughts and put them back together as best as they could, and because of this, he also wasn't sure if he would disappear again if something were to happen. Nonetheless, as Tidus tried to acclimate to everything that had happened in Spira during his time away, Yuna disappeared. Concerned, Tidus decided to search for her and ended up finding her on the Perseid Oryx's boat, which after he fell asleep in, ended up at sea with Yuna at the helm. Yuna had wanted to escape the burden of talking to people about Yevon's downfall and had decided to go out to sea, but the pair got stuck in a horrible storm and ended up travelling back into the past to a time during the Machine War. Here, Tidus fell foul of an old plot conjured by Bevel forces in the Machine War, where they disguised Blitzballs as bombs. Tidus kicked one of these Blitzballs and disappeared following the explosion, something which caused Yuna to faint in shock. She did, however, learn from a nearby summoner about the ability to control Pyreflies, and she was able to summon Tidus back. But there was a price. If Tidus learned about being summoned back in this way, he would disappear forever. 6 months later, Tidus had settled back into life in Spira, and despite not having the same physical prowess as before, he was still able to become a prominent Blitzball player, but he was severely struggling with injuries. During this time, Yuna had wrestled with her conscience about bringing Tidus back, and it led to distance being created between the two of them. Yuna was trying to protect Tidus, and decided that they shouldn't be together anymore. Still, with the re-emergence of Sin, Tidus resolved to stand by Yuna once again as they looked for a way to try and defeat Spira's nightmare once and for all. And so, that concludes the story of Tidus, so far at least. As with such a purposeful cliffhanger like that, and with some very clear teases from Shinji Hashimoto, there must be some plan somewhere for an extension to this tale. And if truth be told, I'd love to see it play out. To me, while Tidus may not be the most developed of characters out there, the role he plays and the sacrifice he ultimately makes, that's what allows him to stand out on his own as one of the most emotionally impactful characters that exists within the Final Fantasy franchise. It's interesting when you think back to that original concept of Final Fantasy X, where lives ended at the age of 17, as both Yuna and Tidus do have quests that revolve around them sacrificing themselves at the age of 17. It's just that Yuna's story was able to continue unabated due to the sacrifice of Tidus. Well, until she was able to bring him back at least. It's what I feel makes Tidus such a fascinating character though. The developers did well to establish his lack of maturity with scenes from his youth, and although it does sometimes rear its ugly head in the narrative, I feel as though they did well to disguise it with naivety. Tidus is fresh into the world of Spira, and as he learns, we, the players, also learn. They use this to great effect, and it's why I feel there is such an emotional connection to Tidus as a character. It's why I believe his character development isn't as important, because in many ways, it's a more realistic approach. Tidus' personal development may feel somewhat lesser compared to, say, Squall or Zidane, but I feel as though it's because Tidus' growth isn't so much about himself, it's more about the people around him and the relationships he forges with them. For example, Tidus' relationship with Jecht. It starts out pretty clear cut, we know he hates him, but by the end of the game, it's almost the complete opposite, and this has an emotional payoff. With Yuna, we see development on multiple levels, from their subtle romantic connection through to him learning about the sacrifice she plans to make. You could also apply this to Auron, Waka, Lulu, Riku, and Kamari. Their relationships with Tidus at the start are very different from those at the end, and this is also a gradual process that happens throughout the narrative. I'd also say that this relates to Tidus' connection to things in a more general sense too, with his wanting to belong to something or somewhere and just finding a purpose, something which he did in the end. It's why even now, some 16 years after finishing the game for the first time, watching that ending sequence to Final Fantasy X while compiling this video was tough. There were definitely tears because it's such a bittersweet ending. Either way though, with this small analysis out of the way, that marks the end of this Origins video. If you've made it this far, definitely give yourself a pat on the back in the comments. If you enjoyed it, also please be sure to hit that like button and share the video around to anyone you know who loves Final Fantasy X. Why not also subscribe and hit that bell button? Also, be sure to let me know what you thought and feel free to let us know what Tidus means to you as a character. Why not also consider supporting us on Patreon? You get the satisfaction of knowing that you're helping to support us in the creation of these videos, and we will reward you by, amongst other things, putting your name at the end of videos like these guys you're seeing right now. Alright guys, thank you so much for joining me on this deep dive into the lore of Final Fantasy X. This is Daryl, signing out. I will see you next time for more Final Fantasy videos.